All right, we are broadcasting live from inside an operating room here at Children's Hospital of Wisconsin. My name is Corey. I work on the social media team, and today we're going to give you an exclusive behind-the-scenes look at one of our operating rooms, and we are going to talk to Dr. Channing Tassone. He is a pediatric orthopedic surgeon, and we're going to talk about how our surgical center is equipped to give the best care for kids, and we would love to hear from you. So if you have questions for Dr. Tassone, or if you have questions about pediatric surgery, please go ahead and post them in the comments section of this video, and we will try to answer as many as we can throughout our live broadcast. And for everybody who's watching right now, we'd really appreciate it if you could click the like button or click the share button and let us know you're watching. We really appreciate your feedback. So with that, I'd like to introduce you to Dr. Tassone. Thank you so much for doing this today.
Thanks, Corey. Thanks for having me.
So to begin with, maybe you could help us understand a little bit about the surgeries you perform here.
Yeah, so orthopedic surgeons here at Children's perform a large breadth of surgeries from pretty much the whole body of any joints and muscle or bone problems that need surgery. So mostly my practice, I do a lot of trauma surgery. So I'm doing surgery on the kids with their broken wrists and their broken elbows. And then the most of my time is spent actually doing pediatric spine surgery. So that's become sort of my specialty over the years, or the focus of my specialty is pediatric spine surgery.
Great. Well, I'm really excited that we're actually inside an operating room. Can you tell me what room are we in and how many operating rooms do we have here?
Yeah, so we're in room 3 at Children's Hospital. On this floor, the third floor of Children's, were our main operating rooms. We have 12 rooms, okay, and they sort of spread all throughout within all the different sterile cores and all the different areas where we keep all the equipment to have to perform the surgery.
Great. And maybe let's start by just describing the layout of this room. For example, it looks like we're right at the operating room table.
Where would
you stand, and who all would be around this table?
Absolutely. So in a surgery, this would be where the patient was laying, patient's head down at this end. And then for our smallest patients, obviously they could end up there, or the teenagers all the way to the other end of the table. The surgeon is going to stand on one side or the other, and then surrounding there will be a surgical tech, and that is the person who really intimately knows all the different equipment that we use during surgery. And so they're typically standing right beside the surgeon, and then they have behind them all of the different equipment that we're going to be using. So we're going to be handing things back and forth throughout the procedure. On the other side will be a surgical assistant or a resident, a doctor in training.
Okay.
At the head of the bed is going to be the anesthesiologist, and so this is all of the anesthesia equipment that they use to make sure the child is safely put to sleep and safely stays asleep throughout the procedure, and make sure everything is done painlessly and asleep.
Now, how does this change for what might be a couple day old baby versus, you know, a 16 or 17 year old child?
Yeah, the biggest difference is how close we all have to stand to each other. So when it's the couple day old baby, you got a whole bunch of people standing around one end of the table. And then for the 16 year old, obviously we can spread out and operate on a different part and have a lot more room.
Now, is everybody in the room pediatric trained? And how important is that?
Yeah, absolutely. It's incredibly important, because taking care of kids is not just like taking care of anybody else. Mm-hmm. It's a unique thing. And so all of the surgeons here, both orthopedics and every of the surgical subspecialties, all of the staff surgeons are pediatric subspecialty trained. All of our anesthesiologists are pediatric subspecialty trained. And that allows us to provide the best and safest care that we do here at Children's.
Wow. Now, let's take a look at this room here. Looks like we have a lot of lights, a lot of monitors, a lot of equipment. Just kind of show us some of the things that are in the room. Like, why are all these monitors here?
So there's several different banks of monitors. If you look over to the far wall, those four large screens are actually what we primarily use to look at x-rays. And so in back in the day when I was training and we had old real x-rays printed on film, that would have been just a bank of light boxes that we would put them up. As we've progressed and now all of our films are digital, now we have monitors like that. And so we will go into our children's system where the x-rays pull up, and we'll put x-rays throughout those so that we can be looking and referring to them during the procedure. The other screens you see, there's three screens, and those are can be hooked into a couple different things. They can be hooked into, there's actually a camera in this light, so during any procedure you're going to have the lights focused on the part of the body being operated on the patient. And in this room in particular, that will also be able to take images that then would be viewed through the screens. In another thing that the screens are used for is if we're doing a surgery with x-ray, so that we're taking x-rays while we're going. That live x-ray, the fluoroscopy is what it's called, the x-ray images can go up there. So while I'm working, if I take an x-ray, I can just look and see the images while I'm working.
Wow.
And then the other thing they're used for is for any different type of scope surgery, arthroscopy, laparoscopy. Whenever a surgeon is using a scope, that's obviously a tiny little camera that's inside the body. And that image from the scope can also project onto those so that, again, while the surgeon's operating, they can be watching there to see what's happening inside the body through the scope that they're using.
And are the tools that you use are specially designed for kids versus adults? Would an adult surgical room have different tools in it than a pediatric?
Absolutely, that's a big part of it. As you have alluded to earlier, when you have a baby that's only this big, you need to have really small tools.
Yeah.
And so there are a lot of things that are common, I'm sure, amongst pediatric to adult operating rooms, but then all of the subset of things that are very small that we do have here at Children's, because it's the only way you can safely perform surgery on the tiniest patients.
So as a surgeon, and you, when you walk into this room, how do you mentally prepare for something as dramatic as surgery? How do you do that?
Well, I guess for me, the mental preparation starts long before I walk into the room.
Yeah.
The mental preparation really starts when I'm in the clinic, meeting the family and meeting the patient. When I take it very seriously when I suggest to a family that I want to be able to perform surgery on their child. That is a huge level of trust that they're putting in me to allow me, to give me the honor to operate on their child. So that's when it starts. Before I would ever recommend a surgery, I'm running through, is it the right thing to do? What are the pros and cons? What are the risks and benefits? And I make absolutely certain that no child under my care gets anywhere near an operating room unless I am absolutely certain that it's the right thing to happen and that they absolutely need to have the surgery. So it starts way back then. Then from that point until they physically get here, there's a lot of planning, you can imagine, that goes into the process. And so that's when we're figuring out what tools are we going to need, what specific procedure has to happen, what are the different variables that go into the specific patient. So there's a lot of preoperative planning. In addition to utilizing all of our medical colleagues, a lot of the spine patients, for example, that I take care of, that's a very big surgery. So a lot of those patients, I have worked with cardiology beforehand to make sure their heart is up to the surgery, pulmonary to make sure their lungs are up to the surgery, and different teams throughout Children's. And that's what I feel so lucky to be here at Children's, because we have such an extraordinary network of providers that are in the Children's Specialty Group that help me get my patients safely to the operating room, through the surgery, and then back out and recover well.
So what is the youngest patient that you've performed a surgery on?
Yeah, that's a hard one. My youngest is probably within days. There are definitely some very young kids, but I guess I would give credit where credit is due and say that I don't win for the youngest patients here at Children's. We have actually a relatively new group that is starting to work on kids actually in utero. So they've got patients who are coming, they've got moms who are coming to the operating room while still pregnant, and then our neurosurgeons in conjunction with our general surgeons are actually opening up the uterus, doing in utero surgery on the baby before they're even born, closing things up, and then letting the baby continue to develop in utero and then give birth when the time was due. So the neurosurgeon and general surgeons absolutely get all the credit for the youngest patients we take care of.
That's amazing. I just want to talk to the fans following us on Facebook right now. Please, if you enjoy what you're watching, click the like button, click the share button, and let us know. We really appreciate your feedback. And one of the questions we had from our Facebook fans came from Lisa, and she asked, how soon after foot surgery to straighten feet, ankles, do kids go back to school? Do they typically stay home for the whole recovery, or do most go to school with casts on their legs?
So, again, the surgery that we do on feet and ankles is really variable. So to get into absolute details about any particular patient, I can't do. But what I can tell you in general, because we do a lot of foot and ankle surgery, most of the kids go back to school when they're still in the casts. Really, the only rule that they have to do is they have to have their pain control. They can't be still on a lot of pain medicines, because that would be not really realistic to go to school. So as soon as their pain is controlled and they can comfortably get around on crutches or in a wheelchair, certainly still when they have the casts on, they can definitely go back to school, and most of them do.
All right. And then Kelly had asked, can you please discuss spinal fusion surgery?
Back to your preparing for surgery. We could the next couple of days we could sit and talk about spinal fusion surgery, because that's my passion. That's what I love to do. It is to discuss. I don't even know where to start with that.
What but conditions the, would require spinal fusion?
Absolutely. So scoliosis is certainly the one that most commonly we perform spinal fusion surgery, and that's for a broad, there's a broad range of patients that get scoliosis. They can have scoliosis with, we're not sure why they have it, a lot of that you hear about in a lot of the teenagers. And then there can be all kinds of other underlying conditions that can cause scoliosis. And that's probably the number one reason why we have to do spinal fusion surgery. And that is definitely a intense surgery and something that we do very well here at Children's because of the specialized teams we have to work on our kids with spine deformity.
Okay. Now, I would imagine a lot of parents have questions about how their child is put to sleep or how the anesthesiologist works with the children. Can you talk about how important it is to have a pediatric trained anesthesiologist and the role they have in the work that's done in this room?
Yeah, so it's interesting because quite appropriately, a lot of parents, when I'm down in that clinic suggesting surgery, the parents say absolutely their number one fear of the whole process is the anesthesiology, is the anesthesia, and the fact that their child's going to sleep. Uh-huh. And so for me, again, I sound like a broken record, but I feel so fortunate. Like I said earlier, I can look those parents in the eye and say with absolute certainty that our anesthesia providers here are exceptional, and I would trust any of them putting my kid or my patients to sleep. Mm-hmm. And so because they're pediatric trained, and because this is what they do every day is take care of kids, I have such total confidence in them that it makes it really nice for me, because the parents are very worried about that, and they know I'm not an anesthesiologist, but I can say with total confidence that they do such a good job.
Great. I'm kind of curious about our recognition as a level one surgical center. Now, this is something that we recently achieved this year. What does that recognition mean when you tell folks we are a level one surgical center, pediatric surgical center?
Yeah, that's something that we're incredibly proud of. It's a brand new certification. Mm-hmm. The American College of Surgeons recently decided. So for a long time, there's been something called the level one trauma certification, or level two, level three. Mm-hmm. And level one trauma certification is basically saying that it is a center that can provide the best care for the most injured patients. Mm-hmm. So the trauma certification's been present for a long time. Well, the American College of Surgeons decided that in addition to that type of a certification for specialty care, that it made sense to also look at hospitals around the country and decide what are the hospitals that can provide the absolute best care for any child undergoing pediatric surgery. So they created this new verification, which is, as you suggested, a level one certification for pediatric surgery. Mm-hmm. The system went live just several months ago. And we were the program got piloted, and there were only two centers in the country that actually got that level of accreditation in the pilot, and that was us and then a center down in Texas. Mm-hmm. Since the program has gone live, there have been over 100 hospitals now that want that level of certification, and we are currently and probably going to be the only level one pediatric surgery center in the state of Wisconsin.
Wow. You had mentioned being a level one trauma center, which we are as well.
Absolutely.
Can you speak to how important it is to have a level one trauma center in Milwaukee and Southeast Wisconsin for the folks that live here?
Yeah, so kids get hurt just like adults, but unfortunately the treatment of kids is not just like adults. Mm-hmm. And so you need to have a level one pediatric trauma center, and we have that, and it allows us for when the kids get the most injured kids, we can get them here and we can take the best care of them. And so it's incredibly important.
Great, and Dr. Tosone, we actually have one question that just came in from Amy. Can you tell me how many surgeries you perform a day?
I get asked that a lot, and it's a great question. When I'm doing a big spine surgery, those can sometimes take, well, the longest is taken 10 hours. So if I'm doing a big spine surgery, I can do one surgery in an entire day, and I will be at this table all day working. So my low number is one. My most that I've ever done was 13. And that was a day that I didn't sit down or stop running a whole lot. So mm-hmm. on average day, like I said, on a spine day, one, maybe two. But then on a normal day, it's probably in the six or seven.
Great, thank you.
And is it normal for a child to be scared? I mean, I would imagine it is. Having a surgery is scary, right? And we're dealing with kids, so there's this extra layer of maybe them being scared. How do you work with families to talk about that.
Yeah, it's funny. Because I would argue almost every child is.
Yeah.
And when they hear the concept, or certainly when they show up here mm-hmm. To need surgery, they all look incredibly fearful.
Yeah.
And my, if you ask the nurses who work in our holding area, what I always ask them, I say, what are you really most nervous about? And oftentimes they can't really yeah. say anything in particular. And that's when I tell them that it's totally normal to be nervous.
Yeah.
I actually worry about anybody who's not nervous going into surgery. And what I tell them is, they're nervous. I say there's only one or two people in the room that are even more nervous than them, and that's the parents. And I say the only person who shouldn't be nervous is me. And as long as the three of us are all there, it all works out very well.
And I imagine another common question that comes up is, could my child wake up during surgery?
Yeah, and it's the teenagers oftentimes that are most fearful of that, and unfortunately yeah. it gets portrayed in movies right. and it gets in the media. Mm-hmm. And the answer is no. That's why these guys who do pediatric, and that's actually probably another really important point of having a pediatric anesthesiologist, is they know exactly the right amount of medicine and for what duration they need to be administering the medicine.
That must be very different for a baby than a 17-year-old. Right?
Absolutely, hugely different. Right. And they're pros at it, and they make sure that none of my patients wake up during surgery. And so that's, again, I can look at that teenager who looks at me scared to death saying, I am very afraid of waking up during surgery. And I can tell you with great confidence that won't happen because my anesthesiologist wouldn't let it happen.
Now, how are families kept up to date during a surgery? It sounds like some of these could take most of the day, maybe even 10 hours. How is a family, the parents, kept up to date during a surgery, right before or right after?
Yeah, and so that's something I'm really excited about. It's something we've developed here at Children's called the Patient Journey. It's an app. And our media team helped develop this, and we've worked very closely with them. And so it's done via texting, and so it actually starts long before the actual procedure, and texts start going out to bring a family up to speed into what kind of things they're supposed to be doing before surgery. But then on the day of surgery, they can get frequent texts through the day so that they know exactly how their child is doing and the progress that we're making, to try as much as possible, and I wouldn't pretend to say it puts them at ease,
right.
but as much as ease as we can. They also always have the opportunity of talking in real time in person to the nurse in the room via the phone if there's ever a question or anything they want to talk about.
So leading up to the surgery and during, it sounds like even after.
And absolutely,
there are text messages that are sent to the parents. So there's actually somebody in this room texting mom and dad with updates.
That's you bet.
That's extremely interesting.
It is, and the parents love it. They really like the level of communication. It makes them feel much more connected to what's happening in the operating room.
And what is the experience like then for the patient or the child right after surgery? Where do they go after this?
Yeah, so the first is in the room here. They just barely start to wake up. When you talk to them after the fact, almost none of them remember this room.
Yeah.
Then they end up out in our recovery room, which is sort of a couple lefts and a right. Mm-hmm. And they end up in the recovery room, and that's where they start to come to. And just as they're starting to come to, and they're kept very comfortable, they're getting medicine as necessary, pain medicine. And then as they start to come to, then we have a family member, a parent or a family member back with them, again, to try to make them as comfortable as possible. It's not some strange environment with no one they know. And then as they continue to wake up, then they would either go to the floor where they're going to be heading home or up to one of our inpatient units.
Now I'm curious, why did you become a surgeon? When you were young, did you think this was something you wanted to do?
I was young. It was not something I ever had any idea I wanted to do.
Yeah.
I went to medical school because I wanted to help people and, or should I stop and we can answer the question? I'll keep going.
No, you're good.
Go ahead.
No, keep going. Talk about when you wanted to be a surgeon.
All right. So I went to medical school because I thought I wanted to be a doctor. I wanted to help people, all those reasons. But I got to be totally honest. I had no idea what it really meant to be a doctor. I didn't have any medical personnel in my family. I had no big heroic medical experience in my life. Mm-hmm. But it was something I thought. I loved science class and I wanted to be a doctor. So I went to medical school. And then it was during medical school, towards the third and fourth year of medical school, is when you start doing a bunch of different rotations in the different types of medicine.
Okay.
And so it was during my surgery rotation that I realized that I could come into a place like this and do things to help people and sort of fix them. And that was when I was hooked. Yeah. And so that's, and I started, I got an experience in orthopedic surgery to see where you literally could fix stuff.
Yeah.
And I loved that. And so then you do a residency, which is after medical school, and that's 5 more years of training after your 4 years of medical school. And so I did an orthopedic surgery residency.
Yeah.
And again, much like medical school, during residency, you're doing rotations on all the different types of orthopedic surgery.
Okay.
And that's when, in my 3rd year of out of 5 residency, I did my first pediatric orthopedic rotation, and that just completely solidified that I wanted to work with kids. I absolutely love taking care of kids. I feel like it's the best job in the world, getting to come here every day and, by and large, fix kids and make them better. So yeah, I love it.
That sounds like we have a question from our Facebook fans.
We do. How many on-call surgeries do you perform, or how often? How do on-call surgeries work? Can you
yeah,
explain that a little bit?
So on-call, we're typically on-call, and this is highly variable amongst the different subspecialties, so I'll comment upon orthopedic surgery. We're on-call usually about 1 weeknight a week and then 1 weekend a month. And that purely has to do with how many people take call in our group. If there's more people, it's less call, less people, more call. And so then the way it works is, obviously, you carry your pager around, and if you get a call about a surgery that absolutely has to happen that night, then we find ourselves right here at 1 a.m. doing what has to happen. If it's not an absolute emergency, but it's an urgency, which is a lot of the broken bones and things like that, those mm-hmm. need relatively urgent surgery, but they're not emergent such that you need to sort of call in all the troops in the middle of the night. So we have a really nice system here at Children's where we have a room every morning where we can bring in the trauma from the night before, so the kids come through the emergency department, end up on the inpatient unit, and then come down the next morning and we fix all the broken bones.
So when you get a page at home, you make that decision at home, like, oh, that child should get surgery. Do you have to call the nurses in the ER? The doctors?
Yes and yes. We have the front line is actually the residents, our student doctors, and so they will come in and evaluate the patient. The nice thing, again, with our electronic system is I can see x-rays at home, I can get lab values at home, I can get all the data that I need at home to make just exactly the decision you're describing.
Great, thank you. Then can you give us just a little bit more of a tour over here so we can check out?
So yeah, we saw the table. Like I think you already showed, this is the machine that does provide all the anesthetic, to Corey's question, to make absolutely certain that the kids go to sleep and stay asleep as long as they need to, but then equally importantly is wake up on the tail end. We talked about the different over, sort of in that bank is where we keep a lot of the supplies that you would need at real time during the surgery. Things like suture, gloves, things like that. The bank of monitors we talked about, this is more supplies that we would use during the surgery. This, I wonder, so these pans are things that come up from downstairs. That's where a lot of our sterile equipment is kept. And those pans are actual equipment that are used for a specific surgery. So that set of pans would be very different if it was a spine surgery or a general surgery procedure or a urology procedure.
All right, and then I have one last question too that I'm just curious about. In a lot of movies, you have the windows that show into operating rooms. Can you can somebody
look in this window right here? There's a window right there of people looking into the operating room.
Can parents watch from there?
Absolutely not.
Absolutely not.
No.
Who does?
Nobody does.
Okay.
It's funny, you can imagine, I get asked that a lot. I want to come back. I want to be there for my child's surgery. And my answer to that is, I do this for a living. I'm up here every day, and I wouldn't watch my own child's surgery. There's an emotional component. Nobody should see their child undergoing surgery, even if it's what they do for a living. So no, parents aren't. This is an environment that really is sort of isolated to medical personnel, not really probably emotionally healthy for parents.
Great, thank you.
So I think we just have one more question. What do you love most about working at Children's Hospital of Wisconsin?
It's a tough one because the honest answer is I love working with the kids, but those change every day and it's different kids. The other is I feel so lucky about the people that work here because the passion that everyone here at Children's has to take care of the kids makes all of us so incredibly motivated to do everything we can to help these kids. And so we're all on the same page every day, and we all do everything we can in the operating room, in the clinic, up on the inpatient units. And so the people, it's the patients and my coworkers, for
Great.
Sure.
Well, I just want to thank everybody for tuning in. Please, again, if you're watching right now, click the like button, click the share button. Let us know you're watching. We really want to see that feedback from you. Dr. Tassone, thank you so much for this. This has been amazing to really get an understanding of what you do and to see an operating room like this. And for everybody watching at home, please, if you want to learn more, you can visit us on our website at chw.org. Thank you.